100 hogs, they just standing out there. My wife can't feed them, and my neighbors don't care. They can't get out and roam around like my old hunting dogs. Here I am in this dang bed, and who's gonna feed them hogs?
Well, the reason we're doing this is because a bunch of you have been asking questions of Grandpa of how all of this started, Brookview Farm.
About 100 years ago, my dad and my mother was born. Mom was the youngest of seven, and she was born right over here on 142 and 17. The house is still there. In North Manchester, he was the ninth child of 11. And then he moved up in, it was probably 1938 or 40, he come up to this area, met my mother and married and lived in New Paris for 2, 3, 4 years, not sure how long, but he worked at New Paris Creamery for on nights. And then Mom was the youngest, and none of the family wanted to farm over there on 17th. They wanted Dad to farm that. Well, Dad said, well, I guess we can do that, you know. So he worked at night and helped there, and none of the other boys wanted to farm, so he took that. And after about 3 or 4 years, this place over here came up for sale, so he bought that in 1947, I think it was. It was 80 acres, and he paid $15,000 for it. It was $189 an acre. Big numbers. Back then it really was, as far as it's concerned. And he was the only one in the whole family that ever owned any land. Everybody else was sharecroppers of his family. And then as that went on, if you guys know Jerry Yoder, his dad was Mom's brother, lived in this house at that time. And after Dad bought it, and we switched houses, so that's how it got switched. First thing we did is we remodeled the house up there. And first thing he did is start building hog houses. So he built, 10, 15 hog houses, slid on skids. And that's how we farrowed our sows. He'd farrow sows and then hog house. Heat lamp, gates out in front, did it 2 times a year, spring and fall. And usually it was mud when you had the heat lamp in there, and you let them out, and you have to let them out of the hog house and the little pen out front while you was in taking care of the pigs. And then after that, we moved on into, we always had dairy cows. And then from then on, Dad just kept having cattle, milk cows, of course, hogs. He got in the chicken business, had 1,000 laying hens, okay? And they was in there was a building right out back where the hog barn is, where we store stuff. We built that, and that was a chicken house prior to that, and we tore that down, put the hog house in there. That was like in the early 60s, 62 maybe. Had 400 head of hogs in there, okay? And then we got the piler in that barn. One of the first milking parlors was, he built a parlor in there. And farrowed hogs in that barn too at one time, made farrowing gates, had hogs to farrowed in the shed up there. We call it the museum up there now, that's where we put our shop in. Farrowed hogs in there. Chickens, and back then the chickens was, the chicken house they had there, but Wally Yoder, that's over on kind of 146. And he had chickens in that house for a while. When they moved there, Wally Yoder did, his family took care of her chickens. So late 50s, I suppose it was, where we're gonna get rid of the chickens and we're gonna do something else. So, man, we got an egg check coming every two weeks to take care of our families. So from then on, we had milk cows. And that 62, when we graduated, Dad says, well, why don't we just, we'll do something, you can take care of you guys, your family better. So we milked a silo, a big silo then, did all that concrete by hand, and got along pretty good with that for a while. In about 66, we're gonna get rid of the dairy cows. We're getting $3.70 a hundred for milk. That didn't work. So, we quit doing that, put beef cattle in there, and worked with that a while. And then Doug, he came in and probably in the 70s, 74, I think it was, about when he started, went into a corporation. It wasn't a partnership, it was incorporated, us three guys, just the boys. And that went on until the FSA was gonna pay a lot of money at that time. We get land payments, they pay you so much, and well, we could only get one check. So So if we go partnership, we divide that up three ways. So we get a lot more money from the government at that time for set aside acres. At that time, we mowed a lot of ground because we didn't plant it. You just left it laying. I guess that was one of the big things then. So we decided Doug come in, we're going to start raising hogs again. So we had hogs going on everywhere. And so what we're going to do without the beef cows now? We always had beef cattle for probably 10, 15 years in that lot up there. So we put hogs in there. Well, that worked out okay, but it's a stinking mess. It was a stinking mess. You know, out in the open lot. You try to go in there and sort 300 hogs out with a stick, you know, a marking stick, and then sort them out. You know, that's how it was. This Rod Lilly guy out of, he was a feed salesman for Prina, and of course he knew where all the hogs was. And Doug was involved in the hog business heavy. And I got into that, and we had hogs everywhere else. And there was a beer and milk that had about 400 hogs, and that went good till the disease got him. And we had to fight all the diseases, and then we went to London, Ohio, and hauled, man, it was 40-some thousand head out of there. I don't know how many years, we get 600 head every week out of that place, till they got so sick, couldn't get them. Then we decided, we're gonna have our own hogs, have our own sows. So Neil Beachy down about 10 miles south of Napanee, so we put about 300 sows down there for him. He took care of them, bought a little nursery, put it down, and John was involved in some of that. Go down and have take care of pigs. And that went south again. It wasn't good, so Doug, we're gonna put sow farm up. So we got busy and looked for sow farms. Company out of Pennsylvania put that big hog barn up for us. And that really went really well. And until we had the nursery pigs right beside the farrowing pigs, and that didn't work. Decalb pigs came in. That was the ticket right then. So then we went to another pork out of Wisconsin. Same thing, you know. So we just finally decided we got rid of the feeder pigs in there. We're taking them to Silver Lake to Brovance, worked at them with a while. And John, we'd haul pigs out of our nursery, get the nursery made out on a sow unit, and then we built our farrowing unit. And you know, things change as we go in the business, and seems like it just keeps going. And so we got through that, and that was really good when we got the nursery going. Then pretty soon we got sickness in the nursery. Can't get help for the other barns, and decided, well, we're going to get rid of the hog business. So, and we have. And you know, I think that's going to be a great thing for us, really. Over the time, the Lord's always been good, takes care of you. You guys remember getting this thing? 1999, Brian started working for us. So Doug says, I want this thing out of my yard. Come over and push it down. I go up and looked at it, and I said, wow, this thing is too nice to do that to. So that's an impossible task, okay? That's impossible to do that, bring it over here. You know, impossibles can turn into possibilities, possible things with the Lord's help. Look at it. So many times we're looking now, wow, we've changed. What's going to happen, you know, in over time? We have goals of what we do. We don't know sure what's going to happen next week, next year. There's some, Lord will take care of us. I think it's a good thing that we've done, you know, really.
What does our shirt say? Remembering the past.
Growing the future. I think we're going to grow the future. There's no question about it. Just keep your head up, and the Lord will take care of us. And that's, wow.
His face was lean and his hands were rough. His way was hogs and his nature was tough. His doctors tried to tell him that he may not live at all, but all he ever talked about was who's gonna feed them hogs. 400 hogs, they just standing out there. My wife can't feed them and my neighbors don't care. They can't get out and roam around like my old hunting dogs. Here I am in this dang bed, and who's gonna feed them hogs? 100 hogs comes to 800 hams, and that's a lot of money for a hog-raising man.
The times wasn't always good for us, let me tell you. It hasn't been all roses, but like I said, there's down times and there's good times. And look where we have. We got a great family. That's the most important thing.